Hello everyone, this is Ashwin from the Global Alliance for Mass Entrepreneurship. And today this is one of the conversations we're having under our campaign 60 Days, 60 Voices, where we're speaking to different organizations who are part of this entrepreneurship small business ecosystem and trying to support businesses transition through this crisis. As everyone knows, this is an unprecedented crisis for India, for the globe. And small businesses are particularly hit. And I think one of the things that we at GAME want to make sure is that our response to something that is unprecedented is coalition-led. And it's a collaboration-led because working together is perhaps the best chance we have to help a lot of these small businesses survive. In that way, I want to introduce our guest today, Aarti Mohan, who is from Sub. Aarti, it would be great for us to start off with just a brief introduction on Sarpa and how you are thinking of your response as an organization to this COVID crisis.
Thanks, Ashwin. And it's an honor to be here with GAME. This is a great initiative and very happy to be part of it. Sarpa, we are a consulting research and implementation firm focused on social impact. And we've been working with the entire ecosystem of social impact, foundations, corporates and their CSR and sustainability programs, nonprofits, and other members of the ecosystem to be able to deliver impactful solutions on the ground. And our role in these solutions has been the strategy to implementation support, research, bringing together collectives and anchoring them from a program management and overall delivery of the solution on the ground perspective, as well as evaluations and assessments. And we have quite a thriving practice there. In terms of the COVID response, we've been working on four fronts. The first front is we realized that there is an information overload. But information is going to not be as effective unless it is analyzed, verified, and put into a format where it can be used by the ecosystem at large. And for us now to demonstrate agility in making connections and being able to go and address some of the challenges that we're facing now, information is needed. So the first thing that we've been doing is aggregating resources that are being provided during COVID needs asked, and all of the information around that geographically and by category and sector onto a dashboard. It's being updated live, and we are now transitioning to a point where we are able to also make it real time in terms of just predicting and predicting risk, estimating needs, and looking at solutions. So that's the first thing. The second thing is we've been looking at orchestrating relief on the ground between corporates and foundations and other givers that are very interested in contributing effectively to the immediate relief operations, along with a supply chain of manufacturers, transporters, and other logistics to state governments and districts where there is need. And Sarpa comes in to actually put together this entire orchestration chain, working closely with our foundation and CSR partners. The third thing, which we've already started thinking about and which is very relevant to this discussion, is how do we rebuild livelihoods and healthcare in the post-relief space, and particularly for very vulnerable segments. So we are working with four different segments there. One is women collectives and SHGs, because we believe that that's a huge informal entrepreneur segment in the country. Then small entrepreneurs, small informal entrepreneurs, and street vendors. We're looking at migrant workers, particularly in industries like construction. And then looking at last mile hyperlocal economies and logistics and delivery there being empowered again by gig workers and migrant workers who may not be able to get back to their earlier professions. So these are the four target segments, and we are looking at crafting the most relevant solutions to these segments. Four is, as an ecosystem member, we want to give back as much as possible by way of information and insights that we're gathering and be part of discussions to support crafting of the response. So we're also part of the collective that's looking at nonprofit resilience, and collectives that are looking at specific sectors like water and financial inclusion and so on, and GAME as well. And that's the fourth area of work that we are looking at contributing to in light of COVID.
Fantastic. And I think just taking on that first point on, I think, making data palatable and absorbable and decision oriented towards decision making, what are some high level trends you're seeing in terms of expenditures? Where is the funding being directed? Where is action being directed? Are the blind spots that the ecosystem has? any kind of high level?
So right now, I think, see, because the data is also very fragmented, but our current analysis is that 90% of the funding is going to immediate relief operations and immediate healthcare or immediate food and orchestrating for that healthcare supply itself. And more recently, it's been going through directives to the PM CARES Fund and a couple of other, fundraising platforms and funds that have started, like the Give India COVID Relief Fund and so on. But largely, the spread has been in immediate relief operations, whether it is through these funds or whether it is through giving directly to nonprofits and so on.
And is there a shift towards livelihoods, economic recovery? Is that something that you're seeing? There's an uptake towards that direction increasing?
Yeah, everyone is talking about how they'd like to grow more towards giving there. But I don't think people are clear about where they should be giving.
Understood.
So there's a lot more conversation, discussion about, are those solutions today available?
Okay.
Are we able to then, figure out what is the right way to give, where to give, etc.?
Hmm.
And this is in contrast to also the agility with which people want to disburse funds,
sure.
Right? Like, and so the readiness of the system as well as where to fund and bringing that together is an important conversation into the right spaces.
Got it. And so the two segments that you're focusing on, which is women entrepreneurs, specifically SHGs and collectives, as well as migrant workers, in terms of helping the ecosystem think about what are the right investments to support the livelihoods of these two groups in particular? What are some initial ideas that you have, Sattva, and you've been talking to the ecosystem? What is some of the hypothesis on what's the direction to take in those?
So I'll touch upon what are the immediate challenges with these groups and then what needs to be probably done as, once the economy gets back to some form of starting up again, right? Mm-hmm. So in terms of the immediate challenges, I think, across the board for any kind of small entrepreneurs and the women collective segment is really liquidity and their current micro nano loan repayments in that cycle, as well as social protection reaching them at the last mile. While the entitlements and stimulus has been announced, is it able to reach the last mile? Is something that has to be definitely strengthened and amplified. But cash is really very critical, in very critical short supply right now. And I think that's, what is the immediate challenge. I think in the medium term, literally 1 month from now to three to five months from now, is the availability of the relevant credit and financial products to be able to restart or pivot operations in the light of COVID. Right, like I think that's a critical need. Two is how do we reach the last mile supply of materials and other equipment if we are still going to talk about hyperlocal or at home or very close to home kind of livelihood enablement. Three is how do we train at scale micro entrepreneurs and then their workers and so on if they have to pivot into newer models and newer production, newer services in the light of what's going to come up. And then fourth is, I think, how do we aggregate demand in a better way? And our hypothesis is that we need solutions across all these fronts. And today, I don't think, either repurposing the current solutions to effectively do this or to come up with new solutions that can extend from the current solutions to be able to craft this, because everyone is looking at a pivot and everyone's looking at a pivot in the light of uncertainty. So that's what I feel. And in the longer term, it's really everyone's like waiting and watching. So therefore, how do we, there's a whole 80-20 thing, right? Like while we may cover the 80% of the respective data and even knowledge of what to do, the 20% is still a very large segment that is in need and this usually slips through the cracks, right?
Yeah.
Like I was in a conversation yesterday where they were literally using an app to geotag where migrant workers are and have a BC go and give them cash in the middle of the slum, and that orchestration has taken like literally five organizations to come together.
Understood.
Right. So I think that's those are where we feel these solutions need to be crafted. One more thing I want to say is I feel the district as a unit or a model of building solution is another strong hypothesis because it won't be so globalized or nationalized supply chains and movement of goods anymore.
Mm-hmm.
So how do we craft for closed loop solutions, and therefore how do you look at district as a unit of production and consumption is another hypothesis to be solved for very critically.
So As you know, at GAME, one of the things that we are thinking about is kind of a liquidity fund that is able to infuse cash to handful of micro businesses that allows them to, you know, pay salaries like 3 months, pay some of the dues, pivot if they need to, if they feel like they move towards, say, you know, trading essential products and services, then that's something they can move towards, so on. I think one of the things we're increasingly realizing is that the money that we make, like, privately or from the private sector is actually a trickle or a drop in the ocean with respect to the need the country has. And so that takes us to this question around transmission channels, and the biggest and most meaningful effort is likely to come from the government on this. And so what are interesting partnerships there in kind of infusing liquidity, using these channels that exist for nonprofits and so on? Are there any islands of success you've seen, or are there any principles that the government can think of? Because they are likely to make the most meaningful effort. And clearly there is likely to be a gap in their effort versus reaching the last mile. And so how do we think about using these channels, and are there any success stories that we can talk about?
Right. So divide my answer into what financially, and then, you know, look, coming to the non-financial ways in which they can enable the revitalization, you know, or recovery at least of livelihoods, and other healthcare as well in the light of all of this. I think first is in terms of finance, rather than doing some things top down, taking a district-based approach or a cluster-based approach is going to be critical. So how do you empower at a district level and at a state level to be able to operationalize very quickly the and serve the needs of cash, and whether it is entitlements or any of the other mudra, loan distribution, or any of the other products that today exist for the micro entrepreneur segment, I think is going to be critical. Two is, since the whole cash flow is such an important thing, and the risk of people defaulting on payments and so on is a reality that's likely. So therefore, what can we think about in terms of incentivizing concessional lending? What can we think of in terms of underwriting some of that recovery part until they are able to pay back, and then buying down interest for borrowers? Some of the means that exist, and I'm sure there's a lot more to be thought of, but I think that's a second level of solutions. There are state and central level, and then in an indirect way, there are state and central level procurement policies from micro entrepreneurs. Mm-hmm. Even before COVID, these had implementation challenges because the coverage was almost close to 100%. All states had signed up for procurement from MEs and the target to be met there. But how do we, in the light of post-COVID, really amp up? Because in the as the markets take time to come back up, government is probably going to be the largest buyer in the intermediate term as well of some of these products and services. So how can we make sure that the public procurement system and the government has put in place, GEM and other such platforms, really come back up and open up? Preferential procurement could be another way to look at, you know, small informal entrepreneurs, because really their access to market is low. Whether it is agri and agri entrepreneurs, whether it is women collectives, small informal entrepreneurs, and particularly rural entrepreneurs, how can we look at preferential procurement of the healthcare supplies, which anyway is going to be procured in at a very large scale? And then there will be several other safety related equipment and, you know, once the economy opens up. So how do we look at preferential procurement? And so the other thing is looking outside of tax payment and, concessional lending. Also, what are some direct subsidies we can think about to help them maintain employment and just, you know, exist till they're at a point where they can come back? And this is industry specific as well, right? And I think that's critical. From an informal worker perspective and them returning back to once these industries open up, I think the government also has a role to play in partnerships with the industry to see how this integration can be made effective in sectors where particularly they've been involved. So I think these are some of the financial and non-financial ways.
All of the coalitions that you're building, who would be alliance partners or partners for this coalition that would really strengthen the work you're doing? And you know, any organizations that want to use this platform, voices in this coalition can be sent in the world.
Got it. No, I'm absolutely. On one hand, there are the partners that can actually provide access to communities and be at scale and be able to, in an agile way, deliver the goods last mile or deliver entitlements, cash, or any of the other downstream, as well as transfer goods upstream. So partnerships with CBOs and NGOs that are working that have been working actively on the ground. And now's a time where, I mean, like an education NGOs that we're working with, for example, are equally able to distribute entitlements and rally around with families to see if there are some hyper-local production units that can be set up. So this is a great opportunity for cross-sectoral alliances as well and partners. So therefore, one category is really who are the effective people to reach the ground and provide access to communities and make sure no one's getting excluded. Second is, on the other hand, totally the other end of the spectrum are alliances like GAME and other ecosystem alliances that can really rally around the rest of the partners to collaborate and bring their own strengths to these solutions. Because we can't go pilot and then prove and then scale. We have to start with scale. Sure. Right, in this thing. So we do need somebody who can anchor and be the glue that can then figure out where partners can bring in their strengths and quickly move to action, literally tomorrow kind of a scenario. The third set of partners are more sectoral and technical experts, right? Where the financial or data, technology partners who will ensure that the solution that is being implemented is done holistically and we get a lot of feedback loops from the ground, because being on top of data as the situation evolves is going to be very critical. And last, I think as money comes in, it's also going to, like a unit that's very, very strongly looking at how do you achieve the outcomes on the ground, realizing that and holding together all the stakeholders within the engagement to outcomes, because it's going to mean a lot of responsive ear to the floor, bringing that back up and then in an agile way, being able to change strategies or operational plans and then ensuring it happens on the ground. So the anchor or the PMU kind of units for efficacy of this itself, and it may not be one organization, it could be more than one, I think are the other critical partners in this. And I cannot overemphasize the importance of partners on the ground who can also bring in data and technology to decision making over and above just taking back entitlements or bringing up production.
And Aarti, just to close, any calls to action to the ecosystem, anything that you would you'd like to communicate to the entire ecosystem, how we should think about this crisis and how we should look at it seamlessly on the other side?
I think, one, I would say that as an ecosystem, how do we be more sensitive to the realities of nonprofits as well as social enterprises that we are working with? And both of them have very similar kind of challenges in parallel universes. Right? Like cash here and cash there manifests its challenges in different ways. So as an ecosystem, how can funders and other members, funders be more sensitive and other members be able to also, given those ideas of how we could give nonprofits and social enterprises a lot more room to do what they're doing, to figure out their strategies, to figure out their institutional ability to move, pivot, etc. And supporting there, I think is one place where I would really urge the ecosystem to look at it. Two is, particularly, considering so much of our my entrepreneur ecosystem today is informal. So therefore, looking at how can we support a lot of the underserved segments, because the entrepreneurs that are the MSMEs and those that are connected to larger supply chains may even be able to figure it out, but people that are below that, the mass entrepreneurs that GAME works with, are really going to need support at all levels to figure out. So therefore, how do we activate the system to be able to be more responsive to the needs of these entrepreneurs and then crafting the solutions and support systems that they will look at? And three is, I really think, I mean, this is a great opportunity for so many, with so many different strengths to come and innovate together. So even finding, ways for us to collaborate as a team of teams and networks that can bring in their relative strengths and also how and their feedback from other groups to then work together to put together a solution. So I would also urge for more of us to look at how do we support by being part of collaboratives and ecosystem collectives, even just to bounce off, discuss information, as well as to get action going on the ground.
Fantastic. Thank you so much, Aarti, for your time. I'm sure this conversation will lead to many more conversations from the ecosystem, and please look forward to responses that come to this conversation and I guess request to join collaboratives that you are a part of and that you're leading. Thank you so much, Aarti, for your time.
Thanks very much, Ashwin and Game, for this opportunity, and I'm really looking forward to do more for MEs in the ecosystem and livelihoods.